Welcome to Talentwise, the definitive podcast for CXOs, human resource and learning and development leaders. This show comes to you from thought leaders who talk about human capital development in today's organization. How to engage and empower today's employee to be effective, competitive and relevant. Stay with us for an exciting conversation with our guest and learn how to future-proof your team. I'm your host Shubhanjan, founder of Knowledge Bridge. Our guest today is Arun Muthukumar, CEO and co-founder, Link Street.
For any business, I guess customer is the most important thing. And today, customer experience is the big buzzword, CX as they call it. You know, the question of, why should a customer walk into a store if they can go buy things online? The reason they come in is because the sales associate in the store can really help them make an informed decision, make them understand what are all the different options that are available, which option is the most relevant and applicable to them, so that at the end of the day, after buying the product, they're extremely happy and are likely to come and buy again or refer to other customers. So that means the need is that the salesperson, unlike earlier days, he's no more somebody who just picks the size and color or does the billing. But the expectation is that the sales person is more of a consultant and an advisor. To satisfy the customer, the salesperson has to be their advisor slash trusted sort of a consultant. And for that person to reach that level of knowledge and to provide that level of customer service, you know, there's crazy amount of training that is required. And particularly if you're talking about soft skills, it has to be drilled over and over again over a period of time. Clearly, 1 day, 2 day training is not going to be sufficient. Even something like not knowing, the return and exchange process can either mess up and become costly for the company or can result in a very angry, upset customer. These are all very critical things that every employee absolutely has to know and follow. So they understand and eventually learn and master both the soft skill aspects and the hard skills like product knowledge and process-related things.
Arun is the CEO and co-founder of Link Street, a next-generation learning solutions provider for corporates and institutions. Arun has vast experience in the application of technology in education. At Link Street, Arun has worked with leading institutions like IIMs and large enterprise customers to deploy effective technology-enabled solutions for learning and digital content management. Prior to Link Street, Arun worked for several years at Cisco and Bell Labs in India and USA. Arun holds an MS in Computer Engineering from the University of Kentucky, USA, and B from College of Engineering, Indy, Anna University, Chennai. He's passionate about making learning effective and engaging and to introduce a culture of continuous learning in every organization. Now, on to this great episode of Talentwise with Arun Muthukumar.
Arun, welcome to Talentwise. I've been hoping to have you in this season and chat with you about the vast, diverse requirements that you are seeing in the marketplace. And as you know, the theme of our talk is future-proofing the team. It was never more relevant than now. And let us get started by maybe articulating the challenges that management and maybe even the HR and leadership, the learning and development folks, they are facing and they are mitigating today.
Sure. Thank you, Subhajan. I'm glad to be part of this conversation. Future-proofing the team is like you said, more critical than ever today because organizations are expanding very fast. And growth seems to be the mantra for every organization. But how do you grow fast? How do you expand without building your team's capability and capacity? And for that to happen, employees need to be ramped up very, very quickly and continuously updated. And unfortunately, that is where I think the current methods of learning and training employees, which is mostly a one-time periodic kind of model, is totally, totally inadequate. Whether it is an instructor-led on-site kind of training or even online learning, which has been around for some time, they all are, at the end of the day, one-time learning and maybe a one-time assessment. You know, either instructor is explaining something or you are asked to go through some material or videos for some time. At the end of it, an assessment is given and then passed and then say, okay, everyone completed training. And it becomes a checkbox that is ticked. But after a few weeks, if you really ask the employees how much they know or how much they remember, I think the first problem is there is even no data around it. And if you ask management, do you know who knows what and where are the knowledge gaps? They don't have data. At best, they can guess from, you know, last year's or last quarter's training data or something like that. But what we are looking at is real-time data. As of today, who knows what, who does not know, where are the gaps, and what management and individuals can do to make sure that they are fully ramped up on all the business critical things. So that need for continuous and quick learning is very, very important. And obviously, the traditional methods, it's impossible to send a trainer every week to all the few hundred locations if it's a large organization. And like I said, you know, online learning, you know, no one today wants to read a 20, 40 page document or go through a half an hour, 1 hour video. That is where the need for continuous what we call as bite-sized micro learning becomes more relevant, especially in a mobile first world where the attention span is very limited and so on.
Right. So tell me, I mean, what do you see from where you are? I mean, I'm sticking to the management HR challenge part. If you can share some examples that say, for example, in manufacturing, this is happening, in retail, this is happening. Can you share the kind of challenges that people are coming to you with and you are helping them mitigate?
So let's take a retail example. Today, you know, any retail wants to expand into a large number of stores. Some of the largest retailers in India have easily a few hundred stores. Some of them maybe even 1,000-1,500 outlets, whether you take in apparel retail or food, quick serve restaurant retail kind of a thing. And that's only in India. But if you look at a global scale, some of the larger ones have over 25,000, 30,000 outlets. That's a crazy number. And they're growing. And from a management perspective, now, how do you train these people across so many locations? And we talked about that, you know, general logistical kind of a challenge. But also there are other challenges. Today, new products and new processes and things like that are coming every week. And it's not only my product information if I'm a retailer, but if my competitor launches something, I cannot wait for some kind of a training content to be created, training to be scheduled, and then eventually training given to people. Because by the time, it's already outdated and moved on. So I think from a management perspective, the challenge is if my competitor launches something today, how do I get my people across 500, 600 stores aware of the 5-10 critical things they need to know, how to compare that product, explain why our product is better than that, or how to answer a customer specific question related to that. So these 3-5 things, that's all they need to know, but it could make a huge difference from a business perspective and convert it into a sale. So it is directly business impacting. It cannot wait, and it needs to be done in a manner that it can be created quickly, sent across to all these thousands of employees across so many locations, made sure they can absorb it easily, and the whole monitoring and analysis so that people absorb and retain that information and translate it or apply it in their work. So that's from a management challenge. Again, I think the other last challenge from a management perspective is the content itself. You know, today, everybody says, I want digital content, interactive content, AR, VR, all that kind of thing. It's nice to say that, but creating such content is often very expensive and time consuming. And so that's another huge challenge. They don't have the expertise or time or budgets to create that kind of highly interactive, engaging content. So we are looking at how to address that challenge as well, to be able to quickly create something that's engaging.
My question is that when I talk to leaders and who say that they don't have budgets, for this. I have a strange sort of notion that you are really talking of finding budgets to retrain and keep your workforce relevant or going out of business. So I really don't know why they actually say that we don't have budgets, because the next thing you know, in 5 years, you'll be irrelevant and out of business.
Absolutely. I think it's probably a mindset or inertia. It is business critical. It is no more, like you just said rightly, it's not a nice to have thing. It is business critical, and it is directly impacting sales and customer service. So yeah, if they don't do it, they may not be around after some time.
So traditionally, the employees have been pretty reluctant. I mean, I'm not, of course, I'm generalizing, but a large section of employees have been pretty reluctant to come into training. I have heard in this season, when I'm talking to various various people, I have heard that management, so when I say management, not the high man, not the top management, but the people to whom these employees are reporting to, they are reluctant to, you know, I can't leave my guy for 2 days for a training because he has important things to do now, so on and so forth. So there is a friction, lack of understanding of the value, so on and so forth. So how do you see the employees responding to the need to change and need to stay relevant, need to learn?
Well, there's two sides to this challenge, right? One, it is very real that a manager may not be able to allocate half a day, 1 day for their floor shop, you know, sales associates to take off and go do something, because you know every week there's a bit something sale or busy season, new things going on all the time. So there is a sort of a real concern around there. At the same time, from an employee perspective, also, like I said, no one wants to sit through a whole day of training. You know, today training is perceived as a boring, mandated task that somebody is forcing me to do. It's also very inefficient, because you know the same material, like a one size fits all, is given to everyone, and people switch off. Anyway, after a few days, they don't remember. So that's where training needs to be personalized, depending on the level of the individual or what gaps they have. You know, if there are 50-100 things they need to know, now half of them may know at least one third of those things. So I don't need to waste my training time repeating those things. So I can focus on targeting exactly what each one needs to know. Second, I need to make sure that it is not done just in a one-time manner, but it needs to be repeated and reinforced so that they can actually absorb it over a period of time and remember it so that they can apply it in their job. The third being, it needs to be made interesting as well. So these three aspects of making it efficient, making it engaging, and making it effective so that they retain that knowledge, they're all important. And that's where we are looking at everything from creating interesting content that is engaging, making it personalized so that they don't have to spend too much time, and then adding elements like training in their own language that they are comfortable with, or introducing elements of gamification as so that it's more interesting, not a mandatory boring thing listening to a lecture, but I'm playing like a game on my mobile at a time of my convenience. You know, if I would like to do it early morning or later in the evening or on the way to work in the bus or wherever, I should be able to do it. And then it makes it much more convenient for the end employee, and also it doesn't impact the work, so they don't have to take off half a day or a day out of work.
I think what you are referring to is the technology intervention which can allow this, all that you described, to happen.
Right.
But my question is about mindset.
Two things, right? One is you have to help them understand why training is important, right? So that's where the messaging from management to the employee saying this is critical to our business, this will help you to sell better, and therefore it's beneficial to both. I think that needs to be done. And then the fact that management is taking interest to implement that training in an easy and convenient manner for the employee, like making it available at any time on their mobile or making it available in a language that they are more comfortable with. Because in most cases, the, you know, like sales associates in a retail are talking to the customer in the native language. So if you give, you know, some theoretical English training, you know, it is really not absorbed by them that much. So these are the things that can be done to make it convenient for the employee. So they are more interested in training. And when they see that, the other thing is what we look at is helping them identify what they don't know. You know, often people do not know what they don't know. So the first goal is to help them realize, oh, these are the things I don't know, and this is important for my job, and I better learn it. So that creates a motivation to learn as well.
So I have two questions on this. One is that, is your activity primarily focused on the sales function? That's one question. The other question is, you mentioned about, you know, vernacular content and so on and so forth.
Yes.
So obviously, see, we know that typically when the HR content, you know, LMS and all these stories happened, say, 10, 15 years back, typically people would buy some ready-made stuff from the West and that will get populated in their systems.
Right.
That was a typical path.
Right.
So my question to you is, how are people responding to the need of this customized content, which again goes back to the ability to invest and all that? So what are you seeing as a scenario here? So two questions. One, is it sales focused? We can take that first and then talk about this vernacular content.
Let's take a short break. When we come back, I will ask Arun if they are focused primarily in sales and how vernacular content is making inroads into training.
You are listening to a Show How To audio original. Podcasting is one of the fastest growing content marketing avenues today. We can help you exploit this largely untapped marketing opportunity. We can craft your audio strategy and leverage the wide reach and easy streaming capability that smartphone penetration provides. It is powerful and personal. Talk to us to find out how podcasting can help you build your brand and reach out to target audiences.
Welcome back. We will dive right in and ask Arun where their focus lies and if it is on the sales function, and how does he see vernacular content taking roots in the training ecosystem?
Yeah, the focus is primarily on frontline employees, right? So that includes salespeople, but also you know, people in services, people in support, or in the factory floor, so that way manufacturing is covered, or even doctors and nurses. You know, you have today, even a hospital is a chain, and you have 20, 30 locations, a hospital, and the consistency of service, even for a hospital, is very important, because any issue or lack of that impacts the brand significantly. It's not like, oh, some issue happened in some, you know, small location, but it's more, you know, it happened in this hospital, and the entire brand gets impacted. So consistency of service is important. Therefore, any large organization with a highly distributed workforce, where the need for learning, continuous learning, is important, you know, the frontline workforce that I talked about is a good target audience for this method of learning and training.
What about the vernacular bit?
Yes, so the language is very important. Like I said, one, people understand and absorb that information much better if information is given to them in a language that they are comfortable with. And anyway, like I said, they can converse with the customers in that language. And like you said, the challenge of, you know, or I think employers are also realizing that giving some namesake content borrowed from somewhere else is not going to work. Therefore, they are realizing it and taking more effort to create that more relevant, personalized content, more practical and what we call a scenario-based content than some kind of a theory. You know, for example, if you want to explain what is upsell or cross-sell, you can't be giving theory about that. And you have to give the relevant scenario specific to that particular type of organization. So if it is apparel retail, for example, a scenario might be something like, okay, you know, if a customer is asking for a shirt, you know, maybe how do you sell him other accessories like a belt or something else? So that is relevant scenario, which is explaining the concept of upsell. But if you just say some theory, they're not going to understand it. And making it available in the local language that they are comfortable with makes it even easier.
How are customers fitting into this narrative? Because end of the day, a business is doing whatever it is doing to ensure that the customers stay engaged and customers stay customers.
Well, for any business, I guess customer is the most important thing. And today, customer experience is the big buzzword, CX as they call it. You know, the question of, you know, why should a customer walk into a store if they can go buy things online, right? The reason they come in is because the sales associate in the store can really help them make an informed decision, make them understand what are all the different options that are available, which option is the most relevant and applicable to them, so that at the end of the day, after buying the product, they're extremely happy and are likely to come and buy again or refer to other customers. So that means the need is that the salesperson, unlike earlier days, he's no more somebody who just picks the size and color or does the billing. But the expectation is that the sales person is more of a consultant and an advisor. Now, so to satisfy the customer, the salesperson has to be their advisor slash trusted sort of a consultant. And for that person to reach that level of knowledge and to provide that level of customer service, you know, there's crazy amount of training that is required. And particularly if you're talking about soft skills, it has to be drilled over and over again over a period of time. Clearly, 1 day, 2 day training is not going to be sufficient. And that is where we come again in terms of providing scenarios for drilled over and over again repeatedly on the mobile, so they understand and eventually learn and master both the soft skill aspects and the hard skills like product knowledge and process related things, because they're critical as well. Even you know, something like not knowing say the return and exchange process can either mess up and become costly for the company or can result in a very angry, upset customer. So these are all very critical things that every employee absolutely has to know and follow.
So where does now technology come in mitigating most of these challenges?
The best part is, I think we are, you know, fortunate to be in a, you know, tech-enabled or world where every month there's something new in tech available. The pace in which technology is changing is incredible. And the good side of that is that we're able to apply all of these technologies, the first and foremost being mobile, right? A mobile-first approach to this, given that today everyone has a mobile phone and data is no more an availability or a cost problem, thanks to Jio and others. You know, even 1-2 years ago, mobiles were available, but people used to say, who's going to pay for data and things like that. Now, since technology is available in a mature, cost-effective manner, we can leverage it fully. The second is computing power and availability of, you know, easily streaming content, video on the mobile, all of that makes it possible so that you can give personalized learning to each individual. So I'm not going to dump everything to everybody. The system we've designed is identifying each individual's weaknesses and gaps and providing a personalized learning, personalized reinforcement, so that learning happens very, very efficiently without them having to spend many hours to do that. And then the third bit of technology is the analytics part. So much data can be collected today. And based on that, we know everything from, you know, individual learning behaviors. If somebody wants to learn fast, they can move fast. Somebody wants to go slow, they can go slowly. So technology, adaptive AI logic is being applied to enable this level of personalized, efficient learning. And that's where I think it's making a huge impact. And the third part is giving management the ability to measure and monitor this. So while all this personalized learning is happening, management is able to get data on what is the progress, where the gaps are, who is learning fast, all of that in real time, not like a monthly report or a weekly report, but in real time at every level, from the line manager level to the headquarters. They can automatically get their teams or reportees' data in real time, so which is very, very powerful. And that's data was never available to management. And with the availability of this data and the analytics and insights that can be taken out of this, it's really transforming the way people become knowledgeable and productive.
In technology, we are very used to the concept of fake it till you make it, right?
Yes.
So conceptually, I can understand that, oh, I will figure out the gaps that Shubhanjan has in as a retail salesperson or whatever.
Right.
How accurate is it today?
It is very accurate. Surprisingly, even management is very surprised by what technology can do. And we have already done it. It is live, real, and it's already proven across many customers, across many verticals. You know, the gaps is a very relative word, right? See, what I know and what I don't know today is different from what I know or don't know a week from today. So that is why the need for continuous assessment of those gaps and continuous reinforcement is very, very important. And that is where our model of everyday learning and assessment and adapting the system to tweak the what is your learning cue, right? The set of things that you, Shubhanjan, as an individual needs to learn. The system is smart enough to keep figuring it out and giving you that personalized cue on a daily basis. For example, a week from today, the things you need to learn may be a set of things that you've forgotten. It might also include a new set of things. Let's say the company's launched a new promotion or a new product. You need to be aware of that. So it could be a combination of old things. It could be plus the new things that have been launched, plus some, say, new competitor information or new regulatory compliance related thing or a new process or a new issue in the field that you need to be aware of. So many things. It's a knowledge economy today. The knowledge worker of today needs to know so many things on a daily, weekly basis that the only way that can be done effectively is through this kind of very focused, technology-driven, data-driven approach.
We started with the idea that one size fits all is not the way to go. So personalization is key. I'm just curious how personal is personal in the current days. I mean, I can imagine that going forward, it can be far more useful, because as AI and, you know, the algorithms start learning more, I'm sure a lot more can come out.
I was saying that there is a common starting point, right? Let's say for all the employees, let's say there is a set of top 50 or 100 things they need to know, which is critical for their job and business. So from that starting point, where personalization comes in is, where are you today with respect to that starting point? You know, out of those 100 things, where are you today? And therefore, based on that, the queue is prioritized. So if for example, let's say you are weak in product knowledge, but good in process or customer service, then I need to prioritize and personalize that for you. If someone else, your colleague, is good in product knowledge, but poor in customer service or communication, then I need to prioritize and personalize it for that person. So it's at that level of, from the larger set of things that everyone needs to know, the personalization is in the form of identifying what are the individual gaps and weaknesses compared to that larger set, and then reinforcing and repeating those things based on their individual weakness or gaps.
Talentwise is brought to you by KnowledgeBridge. we produce customized and multilingual visual training content. We have worked on complex processes, products, and skills development for large blue-chip brands such as Tata Motors, Mahindra First Choice, Homelane, Epson, Toyota, Citibank, and Consul Neowatt, serving diverse industries. Talk to us for your next custom content requirement and be pleasantly surprised. Call us on 99021-631-32.
Wonderful. Thanks, Arun, for your time. It was a nice discussion. And I hope to see you back again when we are ready with the second season.
Oh, great. It was a pleasure. And thank you for this opportunity. And I hope, you know, I'm really passionate about helping transform the workforce of today, because it's critical for businesses to survive and make them future-proof, like you said. And it's also absolutely important for the employee to be productive, because then their career and everything is impacted. So that way, we are happy to be leveraging technology and hopefully disrupting and transforming and preparing them for the future. So looking forward to that.
Thank you.
Coming up next week, another exciting new chat with Amit Bhargav, Founder Director of Procure HR Services.
We find that a lot of changes are going to come in the bulk hiring part also. There is going to be a lot of aggregation there, because not many companies are very comfortable with the bulk hiring. So there has to be a linkage through platforms which are going to be available, like NSDC, National Skill Development Corporation. They have a platform where you have these blue collar people who have got trained by various training partners. The database is available to be used. You have a portal like naukri.com for especially these blue collar hiring. But none of my known had a clue about it, because there's no awareness. So we are trying to implement such softwares wherein these bigger giants, they can ease out their burden of hiring on the blue collar. Similarly for white collar or the freshers, there are various platforms which are there, which are not used, and they are not being utilized properly by the industry.
Thank you for being with us today on Talentwise. We hope we helped you focus on some actionable ideas today. It was certainly enlightening for us. We hope to see you again on our next episode. If you liked what you heard, subscribe to the show in your favorite podcast platforms like iTunes, Google Play, Spotify, or wherever else you get your podcasts from, and give us a rating while you're at it. Thank you in advance. This Show How To original podcast is produced for KnowledgeBridge, the multilingual visual training platform and custom training content creators, by Show How To Audio. Hosted by Shubhanjan Sarkar and produced by Rajiv Aditya. See you next time.